and thank you for joining us on ILTV Weekly's edition of One on One with Alan Dershowitz, a leading expert on criminal and constitutional law, civil liberties, and of course the Arab-Israeli conflict. Each week you have the chance to get your questions answered by one of America's greatest legal minds. Professor Dershowitz joins us now from Martha's Vineyard. Thanks for being here with us.
Well, thank you so much. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. Let's get straight to our opening question. Audio recordings secretly taped by President Donald Trump's former personal lawyer, Michael Cohen, have emerged and are now being looked at by U.S. prosecutors. Those tapes seized by the FBI in a raid on the lawyer's home, office, and hotel room back in April. Now, a retired judge is determining which parts of those recordings can be reviewed. These conversations reportedly discussing an alleged payment to a former Playboy model who says she had an affair with the now president. This raising questions over some of the fundamental principles of the justice system. Our first question comes from a fellow lawyer, attorney Mark Thomas from Michigan. Let's hear what he has to ask you.
Hello, Professor Dershowitz. My name is Mark Thomas. I'm an attorney in Detroit. I am concerned about the recent seizure by the special prosecutor of the client files of Michael Cohen as they relate to President Trump. I think the attorney-client privilege has taken a big hit as a result. It concerns me. Is this the same slippery slope the privilege has been on for many years, or is this a mudslide into the valley? I'd like your take. Also, I'd like to tell you that you've been a role model for me throughout my law practice. When it comes to Jewish role models in baseball, however, is it Koufax or is it Greenberg? I'm from Detroit. I got to go with Greenberg. Thanks.
Well, thank you so much, Mark. And thank you for your letter of support and your brilliant suggestion about a book that I might write. I think I'm going to take your word and follow up on it. I think it's probably, I hate to say this because I grew up with Sandy Koufax. He lived down the block. But I think it has to be Hank Greenberg because, you know, he was such a great hitter during a time of real anti-Semitism and the time of the emergence of Nazism. And he kind of personified the strong, smart, athletic Jewish man who could hit home runs. Koufax was fantastic. There's never been a pitcher who had six better years with the Brooklyn Dodgers. I remember him so vividly growing up near him, but my vote has to go to Hank Greenberg, whose autograph I have in my office. As to your basic question, I think the lawyer-client privilege is taking a hit from all sides in this case. First, the government should never raid a lawyer's office unless they have super probable cause. Particularly, never take lawyer-client privilege material because you're not only raiding the lawyer who may be a wrongdoer, but you're raiding the client. It's just like raiding a doctor's office and reading medical files or a psychiatrist's office or a rabbi's office or a priest's office or your wife's or husband's office. These are all privileges that should be sacred. What I don't know is who leaked the material. The material is typical lawyer-client privilege. You have a client saying, well, you know, maybe I'll use cash. If he said that, it's not clear on the tape. But if he said that, and the lawyer says, no, a check. And the client says, sure, okay, a check. I've had that kind of conversation with clients over and over again, and nobody should ever hear those conversations. But somebody leaked it. We don't know who it is. And then the Trump administration waived privilege because it was leaked and allowed it to be broadcast all over the world. So I do think the lawyer-client privilege has taken a hit, and I think clients will be less willing to talk to lawyers for fear that the lawyers may be taping the conversations and may use them as leverage against lawyers. You know, when I taught criminal law and legal ethics at Harvard for 50 years, I would always warn my students, you know, your client may love you today, but you are his get out of jail card. If he ever gets convicted and he has anything on you, he can turn you in for his own freedom, because the first rule of American law is if you're going to commit a crime, commit one with somebody more important than you are so you can turn them in and they can't turn you in. Not a good day for law, for privilege, or for the Constitution.
Not a good day for the Constitution. But Alan, you have a new book out now, The Case Against Impeachment. Do you see these recordings as part of perhaps a wider political effort to impeach President Donald Trump? And how do you see this new information impacting him?
Well, there's no question that if the Democrats take over the House, there will be a movement to impeach the president. In my book, The Case Against Impeaching Trump, I argue that you need to have an actual crime to impeach. By the way, I would have written the same book had Hillary Clinton, for whom I voted, been elected and they were yelling lock her up, as students were just the other day, with the support of Attorney General Jeff Sessions. If they were trying to impeach a president, Hillary Clinton, I'd have written the same book. In fact, to make the point, my publisher produced a mock cover of the book, which is called The Case Against Impeaching Hillary Clinton, just to make the point that I would have written the same book. I don't think there's anything on the tape which lends support for any criminal charges or any impeachment. Quite the contrary, it shows President Trump saying, let's do it by the corporation, let's do it by check. And of course, no payments ultimately were made. So I think it's a lot of ado about nothing.
Well, let's leave it there for now and bring in today's studio guest, rabbi and member of Israel's ruling Likud party, as well as a member of several parliamentary committees, including the Christian Allies Caucus, Yehuda Glick. Thank you so much for being here with us.
Hi, shalom, Gabi, and shalom, Professor Dershowitz. So great to see you.
Likewise, thank you.
You look lively as always.
Likewise, thank you.
So, firstly, after months of fierce debate, Israel has passed a new law. It's called the Nation State Law. It's a law that its enactors see as largely symbolic, recognizing 70 years of the Jewish state's existence. But its opponents say it's racist and discriminatory and demotes the nation's minority to second-class citizens. Mr. Glick, you voted for the bill. Its detractors, of course, calling it discriminatory. What it's like to bring it up with you and with Professor Dershowitz, why you think this bill is so important?
Well, people have been claiming Zionism is racism, and people have been claiming the state of Israel has been a racist state ever since we were born. We have to understand, very cut clear, Israel is not going to be opening guest chambers for any kind of Palestinian citizens, vice versa. This year, this government has invested 15 billion shekel to decrease the gap between the Jewish population and the Arab population. What we've done, as you all know, we don't have a constitution yet. For reasons everybody pretty much know, and it's time to come, 70 years after we were born, to determine what the state is. It's a Jewish state. This is our language. This is our national anthem. This is our flag, and these are our holidays. We will continue. We will be determined to give every single citizen in Israel full human civil rights, no matter who they are, because that's our Jewish heritage. That's who we are as Jews. When we were taken out of Egypt, God said, you know the soul of a stranger, of a minority, and you make sure to entitle all of your citizens full human rights. But we are a Jewish state, which means we're open for immigration for anybody who's one of his four grandfathers, grandparents, is Jewish, and we will continue to be a Jewish state, and we it'll be clear. And the Supreme Court, taking into consideration issues of democracy, will also take into consideration the fact that Israel is determined and identified as a Jewish state.
Professor Dershowitz, would you agree with that?
No, I would not. I agree with the substance of what the member of Knesset said. Of course, Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people. I don't think you need a law to say that. If you're going to celebrate 70 years, what you might have done is incorporate into law the brilliant Declaration of Independence, which was issued on the day in 1948 when Israel declared itself essentially the nation state of the Jewish people, but it also, in the Declaration of Independence, talked about equal rights for all of its citizens. I think that passing the law was symbolic, but it was an act of unnecessary provocation. I think it's enough for us all to recognize that Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people. Having said that, the criticism for doing it is totally hypocritical. Has anybody read the Palestinian Constitution, which declares a Palestinian state to be an Islamic state under the law of Sharia, and Palestinian laws prohibit any Jew from owning land or being a citizen of Palestine? I mean, that's racism, that's bigotry, but nobody ever criticizes Palestine for that, or the 70 or 80 other states in the world that declare themselves to be Christian states or Catholic states or Muslim states or Buddhist states or every other group. And of course, being Jewish is very different, because being Jewish is not just a religion. It's a civilization. It's a nationality. It's so many different things. which is why I've always rejected the term Israel is a Jewish state. That sounds religious. I much prefer the concept of Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people. That's descriptive and incorporates all the elements of what it means to be a Jew. But I think the law itself was unnecessary just because everybody calls Israel racist falsely, and just because the UN in 75 issued that horrible declaration, and just because the UN in 2016 declared Jewish parts of Jerusalem to be illegally occupied territory, doesn't mean that Israel has to act defensively. It should simply continue to assert that it is the nation state of the Jewish people, but I don't think it needs a basic law to reiterate that on its 70th anniversary. So I think we agree about much of the substance, but disagree about the mechanism of using basic law to assert what we all know to be true, that Israel is the nation state of the Jewish people, Jerusalem is its eternal capital. It will continue to be the nation state of the Jewish people with Hatikva, with the flag based on a talit, with Jewish holidays off, with Hebrew being one of the official languages, but Arabic should be another one of the official languages.
Can I just get a quick response there from you, Mr. Glick? Do you agree that it has some cultural ramifications on the ground, especially for the non-Jewish minority?
I prefer agreeing with one thing. I do think that we shouldn't call it a Jewish state. We should call it a Jewish nation state, or the nation state for the Jewish people. And that also would pass a very important message, which we need today, to strengthen the relationship with the Jewish diaspora. And I think there's a great need for that. I definitely think that it's a major crisis we have to deal with today and not wait for tomorrow. But I think that the same time where we have 8 basic laws dealing with the freedom of religion and freedom of accessibility, etc., there's nothing wrong with the fact that Israel, as long as it doesn't have a constitution, at least should put in the book of our legislation who we are. And of course, I think those who were offended, many of them are using the propaganda and using the excuse, but not really, don't really believe that Israel is going to be changing any of its characteristics.
But there is a much better way to deal with the diaspora. The single best way to deal with the diaspora, and this is very controversial, of course, is to abolish the chief rabbinate, to no longer give religious authorities any power over the life of Israel citizens of any kind, to make Israel a completely secular nation state of the Jewish people, to stop telling conservative and reform Jews that they're not Jewish enough or kosher enough, that their rabbis can't perform conversions, that there's no room for Jewish conservative reform prayer at the Kotel. You want to really, really improve relationships with the diaspora. That's the approach to take, and not to hand over Judaism to a tiny, tiny minority of Jews in the world, namely the Haredi ultra-Orthodox community. That's the way to build relationships. And I hope that Mr. Herzog, as he becomes head of the Jewish agency, will help what Natan Sharansky tried so hard to do, and that is build better and stronger bridges to the entire Jewish community around the world, conservative, reform, Orthodox alike.
We'll get to all of that in just a moment, but for now, let's move on to another issue which has become somewhat of a trademark for you, Mr. Glick, the Temple Mount. You're a longtime advocate of the Jewish visitation on that contested site, heading Haliba, the Initiative for Jewish Freedom of Worship there. Why is this so important to you?
It has connections to what we spoke about before. The Temple Mount is a sanctified place for billions of people in the world who believe in the Bible. Christians, Muslims, Jews, there is no reason in the world that there should not be accessibility for everybody who wants to go onto the Temple Mount freely. And there's no reason why we should allow anybody to legitimize, justify violence on that place. That should be a world center of Jewish tolerance, of religious tolerance. It should be a world center of religious tolerance. It should be open for anybody, no matter who he is, except for people who justify and legitimize violence, whoever they are.
There are Jewish people who say it's prohibited to go onto that mount.
There are other issues that are controversy in the world, and those who don't want to go don't have to go. But those who do want to go should be able to go, and the accessibility should be open for everybody.
I agree completely. I think it's always offensive. I go to the Temple Mount whenever I go to Israel. It's a very, very important place for me and for all Jews, and I'd like to see it accessible to everybody. On the other hand, there was a deal not to change the status quo, and sometimes relations with Jordan and with Saudi Arabia have to be taken into account, and sometimes compromises with pure principle have to be considered. Look, when ultimately the issue of the Middle East is resolved, hopefully it will be, I think the goal is to make the Temple Mount accessible for all people who want to go, want to pray. It is not the sole possession of Muslims or Jews or Christians. It can be seen as a symbol of unity and of brother and sisterhood. So that's the goal in the future. Right now, there may have to be some compromises in the interest of preserving the status quo.
Well, that's the Temple Mount status. What about the fight over mixed or segregated prayer? We mentioned earlier it's just below that Temple Mount, under the section known as Robinson's Arch, the Western Wall. The issue has driven a wedge between Israel and Jews from all over the world. Mr. Glick, as an Orthodox rabbi coming from the U.S., what's your take on prayer at that mixed-gender platform, and who should control the area?
First of all, as I said before, just like the Temple Mount should be a place accessible for everybody, and everybody should be able to pray there the way he believes, I think the same thing should be with the plaza, which was prepared for the Reform Conservative Jews who wanted to come pray there. I think beyond that, a deal is a deal, and if the Israeli government, together with the rabbi of the Kotel and the chairman of the Jewish agency, came to an agreement with the Jewish communities around the world, that we should accept that deal, we should respect that deal, and the sooner the better. I don't think we have to have any organization running it. It should be run by the government. It should be run by the State of Israel, just like the Orthodox Plaza is not run by the Ger Hasidim or the modern Orthodox. It's run by the government, but the government should have clear rules, and there should be no Jew in the world who does not feel comfortable to come and pray the way he believes at the Western Wall.
And that includes praying in a mixed platform.
That includes playing in a mixed platform.
Professor Dershowitz, please.
He or she believes. My daughter and wife were members of Women of the Wall. And there's one more suggestion that could really dramatically improve Israeli relations with the diaspora community, namely for Israel to recognize civil union. That would be so important, so that Israelis have the choice and Jews have the choice whether to marry within the jurisdiction of the rabbinic court or to simply have unions which are recognized by law with all the rights and obligations, but without any rabbinical supervision. There is now a case where an American citizen is being denied a passport. He was actually thrown into jail for violating an order of a rabbinical court, not a secular court, not a civil court, a rabbinic court. I'm sympathetic with the court because it was all about a get, and I'm very strongly supportive of everybody getting a get or giving a get. But here's a case where a rabbinic court claimed authority over a non-Israeli citizen because he was Jewish, an American citizen. That just has to stop. And we cannot ever create a situation where religious courts have authority over secular people. Religion has to prevail on the basis of the strength of its ideas. As Herzl said, let the rabbis stay in their temples, let them preach, let people listen to them. Let people be converted. Let people accept religion. But do not mandate religion from the government power. That's just a mistake. America has it right when it separates church and state, and Israel ought to do more to separate church, mosque, synagogue, and state. It's better for church, mosque, and synagogue. It's better for state, and it's better for relationships between Israel and the diaspora.
Let's take it back from religion and back to the state. Another bill the Israeli parliament passed recently, similar to the U.S. legislation known as the Taylor Force Bill, cuts funds Israel transfers to the Palestinian Authority, respective to the amount Ramallah pays to convicted terrorists held in Israeli prisons and to the families of Palestinian perpetrators, such as suicide bombers. President Mahmoud Abbas said this week they will continue to pay stipends to the families. Let's take a listen to that before we break it down from there.
نحن ننتظر ونترقب وسنتخذ الإجراءات التي تتناسب مع مصلحتنا فيما يتعلق بهذا بمعنى المال الذي تعترض إسرائيل على دفعه للشهداء والجرحى هذا لن نسمح لأحد أن يتدخل به. هؤلاء شهداؤنا وهؤلاء جرحانا وأسرانا، سنستمر في الدفع لهم.
Mr. Glick, this is something you feel personally very strongly about, isn't it?
Mr. Abbas, in the past few months, his statements are really causing mostly damage to him and to his people. And I want to say, personally, I feel affected. Four years ago, when there was an attempt to assassinate me, and the Israeli security forces put their hand on the assassin, and he was killed, President Abbas sent a letter of condolence to his family, calling him a great hero. I think that the leadership of the Palestinians should stop supporting terror, should condemn terror, and should fight terror. Every single time Mr. Abbas supports terror and violence and terror activity against Israel, he's causing himself damage in the international world, and he's causing damage for his people. And I think he should understand that, and I think the American administration should bring him to that point, and I think they've been doing that. But I think the European and the international world should tell him that, because he's causing damage to his people.
Professor Dershowitz, I don't think you'll disagree with that, but how much leverage does Israel actually have over the Palestinian Authority? It's really a much more complex issue than just budget spending, and has a lot to do with Israel's coordination with the authority, doesn't it?
Yes, and Abbas tries to have it both ways. Look, I've met with Abbas, I've had dinner with him. Clearly, he wants to have it both ways. On the one hand, he is trying his best to stop violence and terrorism. The West Bank is not the Gaza Strip. There aren't rockets coming. There are assassination attempts, but they're generally not within the authority of the Palestinian Authority. But then again, he wants to satisfy his street and pay the money once the act has been done. You just can't have it both ways. Either you're against terrorism or you're not against terrorism. And if you're against terrorism, you have to punish the perpetrators, and you can't support their families. You can't create a bounty for killing members of the Knesset or other people. And remember, in the end, the Palestinians who are most vulnerable to terrorism are Palestinian leaders. I mean, one of the reasons Yasser Arafat didn't accept the very generous peace offer of 2000-2001 is because Jimmy Carter told him he'd be assassinated by his own people. And so the idea of assassination and terrorism simply has to be eliminated from the weaponry of the Palestinian Authority, whether it's directly or indirectly through payments. So I do agree.
All right, that's all the time we have for this week's edition of One on One with Professor Alan Dershowitz. Thank you to our guest this week, Member of Israeli Parliament Yehuda Glick, and of course, thank you to Professor Dershowitz. If you'd like to have your question answered by Professor Dershowitz on anything from American to international affairs to religion and law, and of course, on topics relating to the Middle East, why not log on to our Facebook page or take a look at our website. See you again next week. Bye for now.